Hey everybody, it's Invicta. It's time for another Almost Heroes on the channel. Today, we are going to be on the Cursed Hollow. One of my favorite maps to watch, and actually it's starting to kind of get up there as far as my favorite map to play. Here's the storm. On our team today, spotted for Team Blue, it's going to be Li Ming, Rainer, Karzeem, Dehaka, and Chromie. Taking on Chromie, Thrall, Stitches, Karzeem, and Medivh. Obviously, this game was taken from the latest patch at the time of this recording, with Medivh and Chromie both being out. But of course, if you have older replays that are not current, don't worry about that. You can send them on in. It's Invicta316@gmail.com. Make sure you put Almost Heroes in the subject header. Make sure you rename the replay files. Please make sure you remember to rename the replay files. And also, give me a little bit of a write-up and tell me why your replay is better than the other person's replay without spoiling it, of course. Try to keep them under 25 minutes in length. I'll let you go a little bit over if it does warrant. If the write-up is good enough, let's put it that way. And again, thank you everybody who has been submitting in the Almost Heroes series, going over 50 episodes so far and counting. And it's been good. I've been enjoying not only casting but also watching these games. You have to remember that I'm a fan of the game first and foremost. I'm not a caster. I'm not a content creator. I just like playing Heroes of Storm. But I like watching it even more these days, just because of how hilarious things can get in the game. So down the bottom lane here, we're going to have Chromie and Karzeem taking on Medivh and Karzeem. Isn't that a weird matchup to say? Karzeem on Karzeem action. I don't think anyone is going to want to see that anyway, anytime soon. So in the middle lane is going to be Li Ming soloing against Stitches and Chromie. Up at the top is going to be Rainer versus Thrall. As Karzeem for Team Red did get taken out by, presumably I'm going to say, Dehaka, who ended up going down there from mid lane. Dehaka is one of those heroes that I've actually been playing a little bit more of recently. He's a lot of fun. I definitely still don't call him a warrior though, or a tank. He is, for lack of a better word, he is much like Rhaegar in that regards to where he's not really a tank. He's more of a specialist, even though they're both considered technically labeled as tanks. Nice blind hook by Stitches. I love seeing that. But you know what I mean, though? Like, Dehaka is not going to be knocking it out of the ballpark with damage and stuff, and he's also not really going to be able to do much as far as the sieging ability goes, but he is there to disrupt a whole lot of stuff in teamfights. That's exactly what he does, as Rainer was taken down up on the top lane by Thrall. Of course, we are on the Cursed Hollow, the Curse of the Ravenlord map, the Tribute map, whatever moniker you know it as, and this is the map where you're going to see a Tribute spawning very, very soon in a random lane across the entire game. And the first team to cap three of those tributes will indeed enact the Curse of the Raven Lord on their opponents. And that's going to drop all their minions' HP to 1 HP. It's going to prevent all structures from firing except for the core. And it's basically used, depending on what happens, it's generally used by the team who ends up doing the capping by either taking more merc camps or pushing lanes or even doing a cheeky like split push sort of thing. But Curse Hollow is always a good time to watch here just because of how incredibly volatile the game's can actually end up. It's not like Towers of Doom in a way that, Towers of Doom has a lot of force fighting around the altars and stuff, but the tribute maps are on a whole new level because of how easy it is for teams to push the lanes during the Curse of the Ravenlord, whereas Flipfly, if you're trying to compare it to Towers of Doom, you can't really push the lanes as much because there is that firing line. So anyway, we're going to see Dehaka do a deep burrow here and go right after Chromie. Chromie was able to get away from the drag. Karzeem's going to go down. Lots of damage coming in from Chromie with the Dragon Breath. Sandblast even going to be able to hit the other Chromie. Medivh throwing out Force of Will to protect himself. Rainer finally getting down here from the top lane. There's a lot of fighting going on right now. Stitch is going to miss the hook. Down goes Thrall here. Power play back in favor of Team Blue in a second, literally, as Karzeem is going to come back up. Big old Arcane Orb. And actually, the Arcane Blast didn't even matter because Stitches was shielded by Karzeem in a weird way. And Team Red is able to surprisingly get the first tribute here, despite Team Blue having Team Blue did have the positional advantages, although they didn't have Rainer, so they didn't have a numerical advantage, but it was Team Red taking the early power play away from Team Blue because Karzeem was taken out there. So very nicely done there by Team Red. Again, I was surprised that they were able to take that so easily. I thought that we were going to see a long fight over the first tribute, but again, that is the first tribute. You can see the tribute caps down here in the bottom right-hand corner. By the way, someone did tell me that you can actually move the replay, or you can even hide it altogether, the replay indicator. I still have not actually looked at what key that is. I want to say that they said it was like the F9 key or something like that, but it's generally accepted that you do not want to be pushing random buttons while you're recording, especially in OBS and how finicky some of the global hotkeys can get. Not that I have F9 bound to anything, but you know what I mean. Anyway, we're gonna have the second tribute map, or second tribute of the map, spawning down here in the bottom lane yet again. As Team Red taking a very, very nice position. Look at this nice little arc that they've created. Medivh's gonna get this uncontested. I don't think anyone is going to argue with that. Yeah, Chromie wasn't even going that way. Dehaka way too late there on the Stalker. Look at that, Medivh even using the portal there to get out of the way from drag of Dehaka, but here comes the ensuing team fight. Lots of damage going down. Here comes double Dragon Breath. Oh, Team Red's Chromie was able to get the better half of that deal. Thrall taking a big old damage to the face with the Sandblast. Well, their Chromie was not able to land it through the gate there. Surprisingly, no one died, and that is amazing to me considering how low Dehaka and Chromie both were. Speaking volumes to the healing prowess there of Karazim here. Oh, there's Chromie getting the blind bush snipe with Sandblast. I love watching Chromie. I think that it's a little bit odd how much I enjoy playing and watching Chromie. She was a character I didn't think that I was really going to like, but honestly, I'd rather play her over a lot of other casters, with the exception of Kael'thas, of course, because Kael'thas is my main caster who's always freaking banned. But if you're not banning Kael'thas and Li Ming in every single game on every single map, I don't know what you're doing, because they're both very good. Li Ming, in my opinion, is a little bit better than Kael'thas, but hey, we're just not going to go there. Third tribute here really quickly, now going up to the opposite of the map at the top. As Chromie throwing out a Dragon Breath right after, or throwing out the Sandblast right after Dragon's Breath, rather. Look at Karazim getting in there, getting a kill on Thrall with the help of Li Ming. Karazim's going to go down as well. Power play, huge power play in favor of Team Blue, as Team Red has no way to contest this safely. Oh man, that Dragon's Breath did so much damage though. Chromie looking to find out where the other Chromie is, and she's just going to be hiding out in the little cubbyhole there. So Team Blue gets one back for the good guys, I guess, if you want to call them the good guys. I've always looked at Team Blue as, like, the good guys versus, like, Team Red the bad guys, which is weird because I've always, like, red has always been my favorite color, always. And I think I've already talked about the origins of why that is, along with the number 15. But if you don't know the origin, I'll let you all kind of try to figure it out. The number 15 is my favorite number, and the color red is my favorite color. Random Sinvicta fact of the day. I'm actually surprised that the 4 tribute is already going to be up here, and ironically, it's going to be down again. Down here, I should say. Karazim. Oh, Karazim done goofed. Team Red's Karazim done goofed anyway. Look at that! Medivh using the Farsight, not even going to be able to help, however. The Bird's Eye View was not able to save Karazim there. Power play back in favor again of Team Blue. Medivh trying to get away with Force of Will. I don't think anyone's going to chase him. Sandblast is going to miss the mark. Here comes Chromie now for Team Red trying to stop the cap, but I don't think there's anything that anyone can really do. Dehaka even just running right on into the Sandblast, or the Time Trap rather, and getting Sandblasted for it. Thrall wasn't even present for that fight. I don't know where Medivh is going, but that's the wrong way there, rerun. Force of Will not able to stop him from getting dragged. Trying to get the portal, but it was a beautiful silence. The silence was able to stop Medivh from getting into the portal. And I don't know if Team Red is going to be able to stop the bottom four from going down here. You see the slowing sands of time there from Chromie on Team Red anyway. That's Team Red's Chromie. You can tell with the red silhouette around the circle of sand. Li Ming almost got destroyed by the turret there. She's got to be careful. Meanwhile, up in the top lane, Thrall trying to do a little bit of solo pushing by himself, but Team Red struggling to get back into this game. They were ahead briefly, actually for the most part of the better half of the first part of this game that we've seen so far. But it's Team Blue now laying the smackdown with these really solid team fights and getting the power plays when they matter most right before a map object is spawned. Now this one's going to go to any team. Team Red with a slight numbers disadvantage here. Medivh going to walk on in with the portal. Thanks to the Dragon's Breath, was able to stop the cap. And Chromie's going to get taken out, however. And that is a huge loss for Team Red. Dehaka is not even here, but here comes Thrall and Karazim to try to clean up. Li Ming trying to get away. It was going to run right into the stitch anyway. Down goes Chromie as well. So now there's no power play back in favor of Team Red, actually. The 2-4 versus 3. Oh, Medivh gets grabbed by Dehaka. What a play by the Dehaka player. Rainer's forced to back off here. And Team Red is, they're going to try to cap this, but I don't know with Dehaka being here. However, they got the numbers game. And Stitch is going to try to finish off the cap, and I think he's just going to be able to do it. Karazim not there in time, so there's the Curse of the Raven Lord. Great job by Team Red hanging on in there, despite them being down with a level gap. I don't even think they had their heroics there at the beginning of that at the beginning of that fight, but they were able to beat it back with a couple of nice kills. The loss of Chromie early was very bad, and then of course they lost Li Ming as well, they being Team Blue. And it was a good effort by Dehaka to try to get Medivh off the cap. I mean, he was able to do so, but ultimately they did not have enough numbers to stop the cap from getting there. Force of Will actually, or the Wave of Force, I should say. This is going to be really weird. With a Li Ming who took Wave of Force versus Force of Will from Medivh, anyway. But Wave of Force actually knocked back the target there away from Chromie's Dragon Breath. And that's happened to me plenty of times in Hero League. We've got a nice, neat Dragon Breath lined up, only to have it displaced by your teammate, like a Lieutenant Morales displacement grenade. It's a little bit frustrating. Hyperion doing a lot of work. Oh, what a great job with the Divine Palm and even getting into the portal. Thrall throwing out the Sundering, though. Dehaga is forced to go back. And all of Team Red are trying to push down this one fort. But realistically, if you look here, even if they get this fort, okay, so they were able to get a fort up top thanks to the creep wave that was created by the Curse of the Ravenlord. That's also a lot of XP that Team Red missed out on by killing those easy-peasy creep. Instead, they put all their eggs in the one basket. Karazim is going to get killed by the fort there. It looks like Chromie may have forgotten to disable the slowing sands. That is something that I am guilty of occasionally. I'll forget that it's still active and that just consistently drains your mana. Chromie trying to get away. Beautiful wave of beautiful force of will. See, I'm telling you, this is going to be impossible. Beautiful force of will there by Medivh, but was not able. She was just surrounded on all sides. Rainer coming out in with a penetrating round, not able to do that much damage to Stitches. Again, the self-healing of Stitches is so, so tough to get through. Li Ming taking down the gate there. So after 11 minutes, it's 5-11 in favor of Team Blue, but Team Red has been doing a stellar job hanging in there. And even though they're down, oh, there's the Polybomb! It's actually going to spread over to Karazim after Dehaka. Dehaka did tried to burrow a little bit too late there. Medivh throwing out the long-distance portal and trying to snipe anyone in the back line. I don't think it's going to be wise. However, there's another Divine Palm, this time going to be for Team Blue's Karazim player, who was able to get saved, and Team Red's actually wasted the Divine Palm. Stitches is going to go down. It's another power play of Team Red. Oh, and that's exactly what I'm talking about! As a Chromie player, trust me, that is so infuriating when you've got a nice wombo combo lined up. Thrall of Sundering actually moved the entire blue team, probably actually saved two of them from dying. And I feel your pain on that one, Chromie. Trust me, I know how it goes, especially, I don't know if this is a ranked game or whatnot. Actually, no, I'm an idiot. I know it's not a ranked game. Perpaderper, there's multiple different heroes on both teams. Sinvicta. Have you even seen this game before, Sinvicta? Maybe, once or twice. But after the dust settles of what seems like a very long team fight, it's going to be 12-7 in favor of Team Blue. But right now, Team Red controls the map. They're up by one structure here. I'm not exactly sure why Team Red's sending three people to take one Merc camp. Although, concurrently, they also have three people up in the top lane for Team Blue. So, what do I know about anything? Normally, and the reason why I say that, by the way, for those of you who might be newer players, normally you don't want to dedicate too many heroes to taking down one Merc camp, because those are heroes that could be in the lane soaking, that could be pushing lanes, they could be getting more XP and getting your just catching back up, especially if you're down by a level like Team Red is. Now, I don't think that the level 16 talents outside of Chromie is going to really kick into effect for this tribute. But you have to keep in mind that just because a tribute gets cycled, that does not stop the other caps. Team Blue now is only one cap away from getting their own tribute cycle. That can be very devastating. A huge Dragon's Breath by Blue Team's Chromie doing a lot of damage. There's the Sundering, this time being used without Chromie being there. Divine Palm cast at last second. Thrall is going to get taken out by the Hyperion. Power play in favor of Team Blue. Chromie coming in from the bottom here, trying to get a little bit of extra damage done. The Divine Palm did not go off. Karazim going to get sniped by Li Ming. The Divine Palm was just not there. He cast it a little bit too soon, and Team Blue, it was a great discipline there by Team Blue to not try to trigger that. If you see that palm go off, you do not want to trigger that because you're basically giving them a free heal. Chromie doing everything she can, although she got to be careful, especially right next to the Grave Golem. So Team Blue now getting one back for their side, also going up by one level, including one full talent tier here. The 16 talents are very, very important, especially in the mid-game team fights here. So, very back and forth game so far. Team Red has been doing a stellar job staying in this game despite being down by the kills. Remember, it was Team Red who got the first tribute cycle, and they were also, for the majority of this game, in the early game anyway, they were up by a pretty fair margin as far as map control is concerned, but obviously that has gone the way of the Dodo here. Medivh, you see they're using the portal to get back, throwing out the polybomb on Karzeem. Unfortunately, did not spread a huge arcane orb. Just absolutely wrecked the most of Team Red. Unfortunately, it didn't kill anyone as Dehake was finally taken out. Meanwhile, Team Red's Chromie player is forced to defend the top lane here, and she's got to be careful. Rainer looking like he's doing a little bit of poking around the Skull boss area. Skull Golem, Boss Golem, whatever you want to call him. I always call him the Skull Golem because that's what he is. But I guess even to that regard, though, I also call, like, the... On Sky Temple, I also call that the Skull Golem as well, so what do I know? There'll always be the Skull Golems because that's what they were first originally labeled in the technical alpha in Heroes of Storm. So many years ago, isn't that weird to say? It still feels like, I don't know, for me, Heroes of Storm, it still feels like a brand new game. Like, there's still stuff I'm discovering about it all the time. It doesn't seem like it's been out for, I guess, technically just over a year as far as full release is concerned, but it's a game I play well over 2 years by now. So both teams trading for the Skull Golem there. Team Red was lucky they were able to get there so quickly. And this is going to be a very interesting situation as both teams are going to have to contend with each other's Skull Golem. But right now, the Polybomb was thrown out by Medivh, landed on Chromie. She's going to get destroyed immediately. There's a huge silence as well, but Karzeem was able to finally get the Divine Bomb. This time around, Medivh using the portal to get away. Thrall brawling. Oh, the portal disappeared on Thrall. Oh, that's the saddest thing ever. Even after getting the Divine Bomb, Karzeem almost dies there. One final Dragon Breath by Chromie right before she died. Was able to deal a lot of damage, but still no one is dying for Team... Oh, man. Karzeem, I don't think Karzeem realizes how close he was to dying right there. If that Arcane Orb had gone one pixel further, Karzeem would have been the Dedazeem. So while this is going on, Team Red's Golem has pushed past the turrets and is already working on the keep here. I don't... think that the keep is going to be able to take it down. That would be a huge win for Team Red if they're able to get a keep here. Karzeem coming back to try to save it. It's going to be real close. Li Ming, oh, one more stomp may have done it. But that was great progress made by Team Red Skull Golem in the top lane. And they did exactly what they needed to, especially with them kind of being down in levels. I mean, they're still down in levels. They distracted Team Blue and goaded them into fighting down the bot lane. And they either didn't realize or they completely forgot about the Skull Golem going in the top lane. And ultimately, Team Red was able to profit a lot more from that Skull Golem than Team Blue was. A little bit of a miscalculation there by Chromie. I don't blame her, though, because her entire team is not here. But she definitely should have thrown down a Dragon's Breath instead of a Sandblast first. To do the scouting, because you know, you have, especially if she took Enveloping Assault, yeah, the increased radius. I mean, you have to assume that they're probably capping it right there, especially if you don't see any of your team around. Chromie knew it was there, but she threw out the Sandblast first. Had she thrown out the Dragon's Breath, she may have been able to delay them the cap entirely, but I don't think it would have really mattered because, again, it was only Chromie who was there for Team Red. I certainly don't blame her for that. But just as a general tip, though, if you're gonna try to do a deny and you've got AoE, just lead off with the AoE. Don't worry about the single target, especially if it's a skill shot, because it can miss probably almost easily, especially since you're doing it blind. So, but again, I'm not picking on the Chromie player. I don't blame her. It's definitely not Chromie's fault that the rest of her team was not there to contest. They were taking down their own night camp anyway. Here we go again. It's been constant fighting on this map so far. Neither warrior is getting in there yet. Stitch is looking for the hook. Chromie just. Taking a little bit of pot shots at Team Red. Team Blue still has one tribute here so far. By the way, a discussion that I need to bring up really quickly as well, and I'm sad that it took me this many episodes to get into it, but I've been meaning to ask everyone, how do you feel about the mouse cursor being on the screen? I realize that it's something that you just completely ignore until I point it out. But I kind of like having the mouse cursor on the screen. I try not to get it in the way. I usually like to tuck it down below in the minimap region. But I generally like to have the mouse cursor showing on the capture because if I need to point something out, I can just do, hey, look how many tributes we have down here. Or, hey, look, we've got, like, you know, this and that sort of thing. Again, feedback is always appreciated. Karzeem going a little bit too early there with the Divine Palm. He's actually going to get killed right as the Divine Palm... went down. I don't know if that was deliberate or not by Team Blue. Power play back in favor of them as Team Red had down another man. There's another hook by Stitches, but unfortunately it's on Karazim. And Team Blue is just running all over Team Red now, who are quickly falling apart. And this is going to be a full team ace here. I don't think there's any way Stitches gets out of this. Or he's fine, because he's Stitches. Never mind. The self-healing of Stitches is an amazing thing to watch. Same goes for Dehaka to a lesser degree. Team Red's Siege Giants have actually made it all the way to the turrets. Meanwhile, the rest of Team Blue trying to take down this bottom keep, which will be a big get. Right now, Stitches can only really defend, but he can't defend directly against this. It's going to be 4-on-1, literally. And somehow, Dehaka got killed. And even further, somehow Stitches was able to defend against the keep going down. So, again, I don't know what game I've ever watched, but apparently it's not been this game, because what do I know? Stitches finally going to get taken out, possibly, maybe. Nope. He got Earth Shield. He's fine. And he's fine. Well done, Stitches. We're all very proud of you. Meanwhile, Team Red making a huge play here on the tribute. Yeah, whoa! Chromie, I was going to second guess why she stopped casting, or she stopped channeling on the tribute, and the answer was to get an amazing MLG snipe on Raynor blind through the wall. So nice shot there by Chromie. And just like that, Team Red they've got one tribute. I mean, they've got control of the map. If you look at it, all the lanes, with the exception of mid lane, is being pushed heavily in favor of Team Red. And you see both of the golems are now back up. I really feel like this is Team Blue's game to lose right now. But Team Red, look, they're just kind of meandering along here. They look a little bit aimless. They don't really have quite the idea of what they want to do. Do they want to go for merc camps? Do they want to go for split pushing? Do they want to go for the boss camp? It looks like they've decided on going for their own boss camp, which is a little bit perplexing to me, considering that all of them were in a great position to take Team Blue's, and then they could have doubled back to get their own boss camp. Oh, Chromie got stunned there. Nice job of Force of Will saving Chromie from that huge amount of damage. I don't think it would have been lethal damage, but it definitely would have been a lot of damage. So it's interesting to me that Team Red decided to do this. Like I said, they looked a little bit aimless, like they didn't really quite know what to do with the situation that they had. They should have taken charge here and gone after the golem. I really do truly think they could have safely taken this blue golem. Because Team Blue was relegated not only being down by one person, but they also were relegated to defending against the huge pushes that were made in the top and the bot lane as well. But most of them were up to the top lane. Of course, Team Red didn't know that unless they could somehow see the minimap, which I know they couldn't. Here we go. It's going to be a big fight. Karazim now being protected by Force of Will and the Divine Palm. Again, another huge silence thrown out by Dehaka with Isolation. Karazim is going to go down, but down goes Chromie as well. Big power play for Team Red. They're fighting all over the place. Dehaka is going to go down. The Arcane Rift missed on Raynor. I don't think it's going to matter. Thrall's going to get the beatdown, and look at that. 4-for-none scam in favor of Team Red. And Team Red does have their, they do have their golem on the core, but right now there's also a golem on the core of Team Red as well for Team Blue. So this is going to come down to either a base race or what. It looks like Stitches and Chromie going back to defend. Li Ming also going back to defend as well. It's Team Red's golem getting through the shield first. Karazim trying to push it along here, 64% to 82, now 79 and falling. Thrall was taken out by the blue team's Grave Golems. Li Ming still here. The core is sitting at 14%. It's still Li Ming trying to stop Karazim. Karazim's so close, 6%. Oh, man. So all of a sudden, this game just got a whole lot sillier in a solo queue sort of way. 6% to 39% on the core. I have to commend Karazim for being the only person in Team Red who decided to go all the way for it. If Team Red had sent more than just Karazim, I do believe they would have won. That's only 6% of the core, but It doesn't matter now. It's in the past as we're going to be brawling again over this tribute. But look at Medivh. Medivh trying to do a little bit of backdoor action here. I don't know if that's going to work, Medivh. Not safely anyway without your creep being there. The Hockey goes back towards Medivh to try to take care of it. Thrall was taken out again, like I said, by the Team Blue's Grave Golem. Karzeem is also down for another 12 seconds. Medivh versus Dehaka up here in the top lane. Dehaka almost getting the better of that. There's just too much action going on all over the place. Team Blue trying to cap their third tribute. That'd be huge. Thrall throwing in a huge Sundering after he just got rez. Dragon's Breath was not able to save Chroming. Down she goes. Medivh did abandon the attack on the core. But man, oh man, Medivh not being here for the team fight greatly hurt Team Red. And that might be the game because this is going to be the third tribute. Medivh is going to get taken down. It's going to be an almost soft ace. Karzeem going to the top. This is his only chance here because we've got the tribute. Oh no, Karzeem, where are you going? He's taking the scenic route. It's only 6%. Team Red has got a long, or Team Blue rather, has a lot longer way to go, but they've got a lot more damage. Dehaka doing the smart thing. No, it was the catapults! The 1% catapults taking down the core. I missed it. I'm going to actually back this up a little bit because I want to see this. I thought the catapults would have gotten taken out by the Nexus. I'm going to keep the camera right here. This is only about 15 seconds into the past. It's three catapults, but they outranged the core. And that was going to be it. I thought Dehaka was taking preventative measures to stop Karzeem, but no, it was the catapults. The 1 HP catapults getting the victory for Team Red. Wow. Final total 26-15, but your winners here on the Cursed Hollow is going to be Team Red. Again, thank you for submitting the games, everyone. If you have your own replays, send them in to Sinvicta316@gmail.com. Make sure you put Almost Heroes in the subject header. Make sure you rename the replay files, and also make sure that you are giving me a little bit of a write-up without spoiling it. I do appreciate the support, everyone. Can't wait to get into the next game. And of course, I'll see you all next time. Until then, so long, everybody!